Open your Bibles to John chapter 12 and Revelation chapter 3. John chapter 12, Revelation chapter 3, because we're going to use Revelation as an introduction to our time today. John chapter 12 is where we left off last time with very challenging words from Jesus to us as his disciples. He talked about the secret, if you will, to life. And the secret to life is to learn how to die to yourself. Notice with me in chapter 12, pick up there in verse 24. Jesus said, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. He who loves his life will lose it. For he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. And if anyone serves me, him my Father will honor." Now, if there was ever a church or a group of believers that were not living according to these precepts, it would be here in Revelation chapter 3, verse 15, the church of Laodicea. The church of Laodicea that has come to be known as the lukewarm church, neither hot or cold, living a rather selfish, self-centered life, which made for a very selfish congregation of believers. Notice with me in verse 15, Jesus tells the church, "I know your works, that you're neither cold nor hot, and I could wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you're lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth." Now, that's not a position that I want to find myself in relation to Jesus Christ. That when he sees my life and he sees the activity of my life, he declares upon me, "Hey, you know what, Ed? You're not hot, you're not cold, you're lukewarm, and I will violently expel you out of my life. We have no connection," he says. Now, what is the result of not dying to yourself? And what is the result of not sacrificing and submitting yourself to the will of God? Well, you become a lukewarm person. You become at odds with Jesus Christ. You're not hot, you're not cold, you're lukewarm. When you think of lukewarm in relationship to your walk with Jesus Christ, think of words like complacent. Think of words like half-hearted or unconcerned. Oftentimes we'll describe a person that's lukewarm as is just going, you know, halfway, not really giving it all, certainly not dying to self, not living a selfless life. Because selflessness will always lead to surrender. Selfishness will often lead to lukewarmness. And there are many in the church today who come to church, who attend, but live a very lukewarm life. You're neither hot nor cold. Oftentimes we refer to them as like the fence sitters. You know, just sitting on the fence. You're not willing to go one way or the other, just trying to walk a balance. Or you're spiritually insensitive. Or we refer to those that are lukewarm often as having one foot in the world, living for the things of the world, enjoying the things of the world, even though they're anti-God. And you also have one foot in the church, and you're caught between the two, where you have enough of the world in you that the things of God don't satisfy you. But you also have enough of God in you that the things of the world, well, they bring about conviction in your life all the time. So you're back and forth, back and forth. You're lukewarm. Jesus says the way out of that is to learn how to lose your life for his sake. You really want to live, you need to learn how to lose your life. It's an unfortunate thing in the last many years that the church has created this idea of Christian consumers. And maybe this is a word to some of you, where your approach to church, as we gather together, is what can the church do for me? How can the church meet my expectations? And unfortunately, you know, there's whole churches that are designed just like that, to try to meet all the expectations of all the people, and they've diluted the gospel, and they've avoided the hard topics, and we created this. And if we've ever been guilty of that, I hope we haven't, but if we have, we're sorry. I'm sorry for that. That's not the heart of God. The heart of God is not for you to come in the life of the church of what can you do for me, but rather the heart of God for you and me is what can I do for you, Lord, You've given me everything. You've sacrificed your own son. My sins have been forgiven because of the work on the cross. My only response now is, you own me, God. You own me. I'm here to serve you. And so with that in mind, Jesus is in this final message that he teaches to the masses. He is stirring and he is challenging the status quo, the religious movement of the day. Being lukewarm is so far from dying to yourself. Jesus would say it this way, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many." And now in verse 27, we see the troubling of the soul of Jesus when he says, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? But for this purpose," or in the Old King James, "for this cause, I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." Therefore, the people who stood by and heard it said that it thundered. Others said, "An angel spoke to him." But Jesus answered and said, "The voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself." This he said, signifying by what death he would die. The atmosphere around Jesus right now is very troubling. John doesn't give us insights like the other gospel writers do of the Garden of Gethsemane, the depth of the troubling heart of Jesus. He just gives us a glimpse during this time period where Jesus openly declares that he's troubled by the cross. He is now walking under the shadow of the cross. He is now right up just a few days away from the crucifixion. He's beginning to feel the full weight of what salvation will cost him personally in his humanity. Because in his humanity, Jesus is reluctant to go to the cross. You can jot it down in Hebrews chapter 12. It actually describes Jesus as despising the shame. In his humanity, he is wrestling with the reality of what's up ahead. Even more so when we gain insight in his time in the Garden of Gethsemane, according to Luke in chapter 22, verse 42, Luke says, and he records Jesus as praying, "Father, if it's your will, take this cup away from me. I can't bear this. It is too hard. If it is at all possible, if you could save humanity any other way, take this cup from me. It's so much. It's so heavy. It's so weighty." And yet, as he sees it from God's perspective, he ends that prayer by saying, "Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. I accept the cup, and I accept the suffering. I accept your will for my life, Father." And in this, not Jesus, I love how he not only gives us the teaching, but then he models for us what that looks like. And this is that total submission of his will to the will of the Father. And he's troubled. The shadow of the cross is now falling across his path. He's walking along, and in just a couple days, he will be viciously beaten and horrifically tortured and killed on a Roman cross. And it's heavy. You know, there are many things in our lives, aren't there, that cross our paths that cause us to be troubled. We're not unlike Jesus in this. Life can be very difficult, very hard. We find ourselves troubled, not just in mind, but in our souls. We face things that we never expected to face. Heavy weights of trial and difficulty, the weight of sorrow and grief, the brokenness of a sinful world that we live in. There are many things in our lives that cause us to be troubled. There are things that happen to us or to those that we love that we just don't understand. And we try to reconcile them because we know that God is a God of love. We've experienced his love. We actually don't really think about these things until trials come. Because when things are going well, it's very easy to embrace the love of God. It's very easy to enjoy the love of God. It's very easy to live in the love of God. And yet when trial comes and when tragedy strikes and when issues come up that cause us to question the love of God, we try to reconcile it and we just we just can't. It's hard. When we face those difficulties in the now, we look at the situation, we just don't see the purpose, we don't see the cause, we don't grasp it. And under the weight of pain and under the weight of darkness, it makes it even harder. And then what happens? We begin to wonder. And we wonder, and maybe even verbalize it at times, I wonder if God loves me. Because, I mean, how can a God of love allow such horrific tragedy and hurt in my life? How can he continue to seemingly not act on this? And when we think of things only in front of us, when we ask questions about our own afflictions, or we ask the question of why these things are happening, I can't see the purposes of God, we get troubled. We get stirred. And so what should one do? What should we do when our hearts are troubled? Well, I think we do exactly what Jesus does, communicating with the Father the reality of our hearts. God, my heart's troubled right now. I just don't see the purpose in it all. I don't see what you see. I don't feel what you want me to feel in this. I like how the psalmist put it, David, in Psalm 42, verse 5. He said, "Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance." We look to God by faith. You see, Jesus gives us insight. Because one of the things that will greatly help us in the midst of our present circumstance is to broaden the scope a little bit and see the work of eternity in our lives. See, God has us here and now, but there is a weight of eternity that God is working out in our lives through every situation and every circumstance. Jesus says it here, as the Father speaks from heaven, God declares, you know, the cup that you're about to face, Jesus, is I am glorifying you, Son. I have been glorified through this, and I will be glorified. There is an eternal perspective that God has for our life. It's for this cause that he's come into this world, and it's for this cause that you and I as well, that we're here to do the will of the Father and to drink the cup that God has for us. And so we begin to see, like Jesus does, our situation from an eternal perspective, a much bigger picture than we currently see. When our soul is troubled over our immediate problems, it is good that if we can put the problem in light of eternity, it will gain greater comfort in the circumstance. Well, what does that look like? Turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, would you? 2 Corinthians chapter 4. This passage has become quite familiar to us as a congregation, as so many of us have been through trials over the last few years, and me in particular. It's been a massive passage that I've often referred to because it has come to life in our lives. It's come to life in our lives. It's come to life in our congregation. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, draw your attention to verse 16. It's so good that if we can put the problem in light of eternity and we can see more of the eternal perspective, that God will comfort us in our difficulty. And so he says in verse 16, "Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing." Can anyone give an amen to that? Amen. All right, you can feel it, can't you? Like, man, our bodies, everything about our bodies, our minds, the outward man is perishing, but the inward man is being renewed day by day. Can I also get an amen for that? God is working in you. Your bodies are wearing down. Eternity awaits us. I mean, in light of eternity, 50 years is just a shadow. 75 years is just a vapor. And while the outward man is perishing, God is doing a work on the inward man. But not only that, for our light affliction, verse 17. Now, how could we possibly ever call the things we face light affliction unless we saw them in light of eternity? Because in the moment, in the now, it's the heaviest, hardest thing we've ever faced. For us, in order for us to gain the perspective of the Holy Spirit here, to see things as a light affliction, we have to understand they're just for a moment. It's just for a moment. It's just for a moment. Notice this light affliction, verse 17, is working what? For us. You might want to mark that if you haven't already. They're working for us, not against us. A far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You see, as we gain the eternal purpose through suffering, and we recognize the cause for which we've come into the world, for God to use our lives to glorify his name, to point people to the cross of Jesus Christ, to the resurrection power that comes by faith in him. God is working out his eternal purposes and his eternal plan through our temporary pain and afflictions that we face in a sin-sick world. And as I see it in light of eternity, then there's that final submission of Jesus, and through my submission to the Father, he is glorified through my life. Now, we are perfectly okay with God glorifying himself through our lives without pain. And we embrace that. And we're perfectly okay, man. Things are going great. I've got the promotion at work. All my bills are paid. My relationship is strong. God, glorify your name in our lives. And we cry out for it. And yet we have to have the same perspective when things don't go our way. When we face the trials and tribulations that are promised to all of us. You know what, Father? My life is yours. You bought me with your blood. I belong to you in the good times and the bad. Naked I came into this world, Job said. Naked I will leave. Hey, Lord, blessed be the name of the Lord. That's the perspective that Jesus gives us here in his own life through humanity. Jesus goes in his prayer from save me from this hour to the submission, Lord, glorify thy name. And we would do well to follow in his footsteps. And though it bring pain and suffering to me, Lord, glorify your name. That's true submission to the will of God. And I think it's so important for us that we come to the place where we submit our issues to the Lord. Lord, you work. God, you glorify your name. Then we experience true peace. Lord, whatever you want. You know, as a new believer, that was your prayer. In those early days of being saved, your prayer was, whatever you want, Lord. I give you my whole house. I give you everything that I have. Search every part of my life and whatever you want. But over time, something happens and it's no longer whatever you want, Lord. Now it becomes whatever you want, but I don't want to hurt. And whatever you want, but I don't want any pain. Whatever you want, but I can handle this. And oh, it would do well for us to come back to that place of submission. Say, God, whatever you want in my life, I'm yours. And if this suffering is serving an eternal purpose, then fine, Lord, use it and I'll accept it. And if this trial is going to bring about eternal benefits, then fine, Lord, I submit to you. Paul the Apostle, in writing his second letter to the Corinthians, he says this. I'll read it to you from the New Living Translation in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Because it's not just an eternal purpose, there's also a purpose in the here and now. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3, he says, all praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the source of every mercy and the God who comforts us. He comforts us, verse 4, in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. When others are troubled, we'll be able to give them the same comfort that God has given us. You can be sure that the more we suffer for Christ, the more God will shower us with his comfort through Christ. So when we're weighed down with troubles, it is for your benefit and salvation. For when God comforts us, it's so that we in turn can be an encouragement to you. Then you can patiently endure the same things we suffer. You know, it's really hard for us to truly comfort and sympathize with someone without having faced some sinful, similar painful experience. The painful experiences of our lives break our hearts and open up channels for the Holy Spirit to flow through us in his agape, selfless love in ways that nothing and no one else could ever do. And it's difficult for us to be able to connect with someone really close unless we face some painful experience. It's challenging to really understand the pain and the hurt unless you've been there. Now, that's not to say that you can't serve someone, and it's not to say that you can't open the scripture with someone if you haven't experienced what they've gone through. You can and you should. But when you've gone through it, your heart immediately is connected with them because you've received comfort. And now the comfort you give is not just a hopeful comfort, but it's hope within reality because you've experienced it. It's your life that you're sharing. And when you've been there, and you've experienced that blessed work of the Holy Spirit in comforting your heart, in strengthening you to go through, in helping you to take the next step, then you can comfort someone else because you've been through it. So it's not just an eternal plan that God is working out, but he's actually using the present condition and the things that trouble our soul and the cup that we none of us want to take. He's actually using it in the present time as well as a tool to draw people to himself. Remember Jesus, he said, as I'm lifted up, I'll draw people to myself. Now, oftentimes we'll use that. Some churches will use that kind of in their worship service. Okay, everybody, let's lift Jesus up and he'll be here and he'll draw us to himself. That's actually not what Jesus said at all. Now, I do believe the scriptures when it says that God inhabits the praises of his people, but when he's lifted up, he's not speaking of hyped up emotional worship. He's saying, look, when I die, people are going to be attracted to me. When I rise again from the dead, people will see the value and the weight of eternity upon their lives. When they look upon my life and my death and innocence and that God from heaven would love us so much he'd send his own son to die for us, that will draw people to me. And so it is true in the things that you face. Isn't it true? You have gone through some tragedy and some difficulty. And now through the tragedy and difficulty, you find yourself as a magnet to people that have gone through what you've gone through. They seem to come to you. They seem to seek you out. You faced one particular pain, and now all of a sudden you've got three or four people going, finding out your story and wanting to come to you for what? The comfort that you've received from the Lord, the hope that you've received, the strength that you've received. I mean, it's true. It's to be expected. You really begin to comfort people that have gone through it, even though you may not welcome that part of ministry in your life. You're connected to people from now on through your pain. I mean, I think of it in my own life. Every time I hear of a family that have lost a loved one, a mom, a dad, my heart immediately is connected with them, even if I don't know them. Immediately. Even more so when I hear of a family tragically losing a child. My heart is immediately connected with them. I mean, it just sinks down deep. I grasp a sense. Not to entirety, but I grasp a sense and a part of what they're feeling. The searing pain of emptiness and loss, the aches in their throat, the sleepless nights, the bitterness of tears, the hopelessness, I can touch a little bit of that. You know, many of us watched the same news this week, but a few of us, our hearts sank very, very deeply as we watched the tragic story of Colorado State Trooper Jamie, who lost her life down south on I-25 in Larkspur. She was a part of the Castle Rock troop where my son Eddie was a part of. They were co-workers. She was even there encouraging us at the funeral of our son. And when I watched that, my heart sunk because of the closeness and the proximity of that small group of family of which my son was a part of. And I'm sure that you have the same types of connections that when you hear or you see, and because of what you have gone through or what you're presently going through, your heart is immediately connected in a way that the person sitting next to you isn't. That's because God is using your pain. He's opening up channels in your life that you might be used in a way that you've never been used before. Now, that may not take away all the pain, and it certainly doesn't. And it may not comfort you all that much today to think, you know, I would rather be used of the Lord in a different way. But we're reminded of what Paul says, this light affliction, it's just for a moment. And your heart is connected. You know, how can you not be connected with those that have experienced what you're going through? How can you not be connected and want to speak forth the love and the hope and the patience and the faith that God has shown you? How can you not be connected with those that you have know that you've walked down a similar road? And our hearts go out to those that have lost loved ones. Our hearts go out that are separated from their kids and their grandkids in a way that doesn't please the Lord. Our hearts go out. They connect. Those of you that experience separation and divorce, the searing pain. Those of you that are single parents, how can you not think of the single parents in your life? Those of you that are financially strapped and just struggling for work and hard to pay the bills, how can you not immediately want to reach out to someone else that's struggling just like you? That's where Jesus is here. Hey, God says, I have been glorified and I will be glorified again. Those are powerful words. And God will be glorified in the good in our lives, and God will be glorified in the pain of our lives, and we will be used. Now, back in John chapter 12, notice, In verse 31, there's a neat little encouragement here where it says, now the judgment of this world, now the ruler of this world will be cast out. At the cross, Satan was defeated. He was rendered powerless. He was defeated. Paul would write to the Colossians that he was rendered ineffective. And so we ask, well, man, why is he such a hassle today then? If he's been rendered ineffective, why is he such a hassle? Well, each time you and I choose to compromise in sin, we give a foothold to the devil. We then give back power to him through our bad decisions. You see, right now, in the midst of your addiction, you are free in Jesus Christ. Right now, in the midst of your anger, you are free in Jesus Christ. In every form of the flesh, in every temptation of the devil, you are strong and free in the Lord. Why? Because at the cross, the ruler of this world is going to be cast out. The work of Jesus has been done. Remember that. And be careful with all these decisions that you make. That this is the freedom that comes by faith in Jesus Christ. Now, verse 34. In light of this, notice how the people responded. Verse 34. The people answered him, "We have heard from the law that Christ remains forever. And how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?" Then Jesus said to them, "A little while longer the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light." These things Jesus spoke and departed and was hidden from them. This question isn't a genuine question. They've taken the life-giving words of Jesus and made it into a theological argument. And oftentimes people will do that. The life-saving words of Jesus Christ, if they will die to themselves, place their faith in Jesus Christ, their whole eternity will be changed. And what's their question? Hey, wait a minute. I thought the Bible said that this was going to happen and this is going to happen. I thought the Bible said that who is this Son of Man and what is this all about? They refuse to believe. And I like how Jesus doesn't even get into the argument. He just repeats the same thing a different way. Hey, the light is here. Walk in the light. Do it now while you can. Darkness is coming. And he strongly, as he will at the end of the chapter, reminds them of the opportunity of life that's right before them. Be careful when you're faced with truth not to turn it into some theological argument or to ask endless questions of something that you already understand. Now, there are places for good, solid questions that will help you understand something, but there's no place for the types of questions that keep pushing away. The Bible describes a group of people that are always learning but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. Be careful there. The gospel couldn't be plainer, that you and I have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that we have been separated from God by our own sinful actions. And because of that separation, God in his great love for us sent his own Son, Jesus Christ, to fulfill all the promises that he made previously, but also to make available to you through his death and resurrection the only way of salvation available, that your sins and mine can be forgiven, that you and I will not have to live with the burden of guilt any longer, that we can have eternal life both in the future, but also now, that life can have meaning, that can have eternal purpose, that today, if you'll turn your life away from sin, you'll repent of your sins and submit your life to Jesus Christ, the Bible says you will be saved. The Bible actually says it this way. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Jesus would put it this way. While, verse 36, you have the light, believe in the light that you may become sons of light. And then verse 37, but although he had done so many signs before them, they didn't believe in him. They refused to believe. They received the teaching and the validation through signs and wonders, and they refused to believe. So that the word of Isaiah would be fulfilled, verse 38, that he spoke, "Lord, who's believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" Therefore, they could not believe, because Isaiah said again, "He has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, lest they should see with their eyes and understand with their heart, lest they should turn so that I should heal them." And these things Isaiah said when he saw his glory and spoke of him. Now, that's a troubling verse, isn't it? Verse 39. For some of you, it should be troubling. They came to a place where they could not believe. You go, wait a minute, what's that all about? Why couldn't they believe? Because they refused to believe. And each time you harden your heart gets harder. And there's even the time where, like Pharaoh, you remember back in the Old Testament in Exodus, Pharaoh hardened his heart before God. God sent him a messenger, Moses, with a message and signs and wonders. And each time, in response to the message of God and the validation of God, Pharaoh hardened his heart. What happened to a hardened heart? Then God hardened his heart. And then Pharaoh hardened his heart, and God hardened his heart. And before you know it, Pharaoh was so hardened that he could not believe. And this is a warning to those of you that have hardened your heart. There will come a time when you cannot believe. Your heart will be so hard you won't believe. There'll be no room for softness anymore. It's been said that the same sun, the heat of the sun that melts the wax, is the same sun that will harden the clay. And it really becomes the substance that God has to work with. And today, the Bible says, if you will hear his voice, today is the day of salvation. While you can hear and while you're still interested and while there's hope, today is a day of salvation. And in just a few minutes, you have an opportunity to respond to the invitation to turn away from your sin and to turn toward Jesus Christ. Notice in verse 42, nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed in him. That's good. Many believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they didn't openly confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. For they love the praise of men more than the praise of God. That's a tragedy. Some of you believers, because of the environment, you're out at college or you're at school or you're at work, and you believe, but you refuse to confess because you're afraid and you have the fear of man in you. And I just pray the Lord would remove that from you, that you would see the hope of heaven in other people's lives, that you wouldn't worry about. In this case, they liked the praise of men. They liked the accolades of men. They liked men to pay attention to them. And they knew when they confessed Jesus Christ, many people would turn. And I wonder if Nicodemus wasn't a part of this group for a while. We know later on he comes out and he openly confesses. I wonder if Joseph of Arimathea wasn't a part of this group for a while. Because we know later on he will openly come out and confess after his death, Jesus' death and resurrection. But I wonder really if you're one of these, where you believe, but you won't confess because you're afraid of man and you're afraid of what man might do. Jesus put it this way, hey, don't you worry about fearing man that can put your body to death. You fear God that can put both your body and soul. You fear God and he'll take care of the rest. The Bible says, if my ways please the Lord, that he can make even our enemies be at peace with us. You have nothing to be ashamed of with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul declared that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ because it is the power of God unto salvation for all that believe, for the Jew first and then for the Greek. That means basically a statement, all of us can be saved by faith in Jesus Christ. Don't be like these guys where they believed, but they wouldn't confess. Well, it makes you wonder what kind of relationship they really had. And hopefully after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, they drop their fear and live with boldness. Then Jesus cried out, verse 44, he who believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me. And he who sees me sees him who sent me. I have come as a light into the world that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. And if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I don't judge him. For I did not come to the world to judge, but to save the world. Verse 48, he who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command that I should of what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak. For John, his last recorded message of Jesus Christ is evangelistic. Reminding, hey, I come with a message. You believe in me. You believe in the Father. This is true salvation. And he talks about four times he uses the word judge in this section. Because the gospel includes heaven and hell. The gospel message includes eternal life and eternal death. The gospel message includes forgiveness and sin. And Jesus says, hey, it's not me that judges. My words that I've shared with you, the decisions that you make, they weigh on judgment against you. But while it's light, follow the light. Follow. Don't willfully choose not to believe. The more you harden your heart and reject the gospel, the easier it will be to live in that hardness and rejection. Judgment is a reality, but Jesus didn't come to judge. He came to give life, to save you, to rescue you, to help you. But if the sinner doesn't repent, then Jesus Christ the Savior becomes Jesus the judge. And forever he will judge everything by the cross. That will be the epicenter of all judgment, will be the cross of Jesus Christ. And he ends his ministry with the promise that he who embraces his word, his public ministry now is ended with the word that if you believe, you'll have eternal life. No more multitude messages from now on. From the rest of the way of our study throughout the end, we're in the last week of Jesus. It's the last half of the Gospel of John, but it only really covers 7 days of the life of Jesus. The last part of this book, in the next 4 or 5 chapters, will be all Jesus discipling his disciples, preparing him for what's up ahead, preparing him for his departure, talking about what's known as the upper room discourse. We have Jesus there washing feet in the next chapter, what true service is like, the authority of God's word. He's going to prepare them and prepare us for the last days, for the days of which we won't have the presence of Jesus any longer. We have the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit, but we also await the soon return of Jesus Christ. So read ahead and study ahead and be open for a work of the Spirit in your life. For some of you, I recognize it's very hard. It's going to be very hard until you meet Jesus face to face. That has been the lot of your life. But there is an eternal perspective that God would have us to gain. And there's also a timely now perspective that God would give to us. And I'm just personally encouraged. I was putting this together and coming back from the trip, and then I was rereading my notes and preparing for it and making little note changes. And then it wasn't until last night when I was teaching where the Holy Spirit was just speaking to my heart of this one verse in verse 28, that the Father would look at my life and yours and say, I have glorified my name in your life, Ed, and I'll glorify it again. That's something you can hold on to. You can put your name in there. I have glorified. The Father says, I'm glorifying my name through your life, and I still will. You're like, wow, Lord, that's pretty encouraging. And I pray you leave with that encouragement today as we now come to that time of communion. So God, difficult words as we watch this difficult season in your life, Jesus, but life-giving words, encouragement. I look out on our precious congregation, and by face, I can see pain. And by face, I can recall the times I was at the hospital, or I was on the phone, or I was with that family, or I've heard the report from the pastoral team of that family, or that difficulty, or that tragedy, or that unfairness, or unjustness, or the list goes on that, Lord, we have come to live in this sin-sick world, and we just ask today for a special anointing of your Holy Spirit upon us, that we are unable to take the next step, to take the next breath, to think the next thought without the empowering of your resurrection power in our lives. So we submit ourselves to you, Lord. Some today even submit their situation to you fresh and new, that this eternal weight of glory would replace this temporary weight of agony in our lives. And I pray for those that are hurting and those that are struggling. And as that brother came up today after first service, the consequences of past decisions are plaguing him. And on the list can go. But we live not a hopeless life. We live a hopeful life. And we trust you, God. We trust you when we can see, and we trust you when we can't see. We trust you when we understand, God, and we trust you when we don't understand. And when we come up to something that we don't understand, God, we will fall back on those things that we do understand, because we know and have experienced your love for us. And we know and experience your rescuing power in our lives. And we know of an experience that even in the greatest tragedies, in the greatest injustices of life, you can turn around for the good. And you have. And we trust you today as we come to the communion table. And for some of you, as we're praying, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. And I understand while I was away, there's been this special outpouring of the Holy Spirit in drawing people to himself, and that I'm grateful. But perhaps you haven't yet given your life to Jesus Christ, and today's the day. while the light is being shared with you, it's time to believe and not harden your heart any longer. And so before we pass out the elements of communion, I want to invite you, if you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you're here in the sanctuary, you're watching downstairs on one of the TVs or in the overflow room, you're out on Grace TV or you're listening on the radio live or at some other time, today is the day of salvation. And I want to invite you, if that's you and that describes your life, and you know you need to turn away from your sin and embrace Jesus Christ, giving and submitting your life to him, I'm going to invite you right where you're at. Would you stand to your feet? We'd like to pray for you. At every service, someone's given their life to the Lord this weekend, and today we wait for you. If today is the day that you say, you know what, Pastor, I need to give my life to Jesus Christ, I'm inviting you to do that right now. Right before, we wait for you. If that's you, respond. Stand up and give yourself away to say, you know what, that's the day I stood. That's the day I committed. That's the day I gave myself to God. I accepted salvation. God bless you in the back. Who else would say, that's me? You know who you are. God has got that x-ray into your soul. And maybe it's your soul that's troubled, that's drawing your attention to God. It's exactly what he said, isn't it? He'll be lifted up. In being lifted up, he is hope. He is help. And he is the only way for you to be made right with God. Who else would say, that's me? I recognize for some of you, I can't see you. You're in another room or in another state or another part of the world, but God knows you and sees you, and may you be blessed in your commitment to follow him. And so as I mentioned earlier, the Bible says that confession with your mouth is important and believing in your heart is part of the package. So let me lead you in a prayer that you can pray directly to God right now. And you can use my words if you'd like, or you can modify them. But the importance is you recognize this all-consuming surrender to God, turning away, what the Bible calls repentance, turning away from your sin, saying, I don't want that in my life anymore, and submitting your life to God. So you could say something like this. You could say, God, I admit that I have sinned against you and that my sins have separated me from you. And because I believe in the birth and the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because what he has done in my life, I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. Help me to live my life for you. God, give me the strength to turn away from my sinful past and help me to understand your scriptures, your Bible, that my life would glorify you. And God, I know anyone that would cry out to you from the genuine sincerity of their heart, you hear that prayer. And I pray that, and I ask that you would draw them in an ever closer relationship with you, and that there would be a reality manifested in their lives. And as we come to your communion table, I pray for the pain. I pray for the sorrow in this room. I pray for the loneliness. I pray for the unneeded and unwanted separations. I pray, God, for the divorces, the anguish. I was so encouraged this week where I saw a couple that was standing, sitting before the judge, so hesitant to go forward, and they left not divorcing to give it another chance. I pray that into some lives right now, that you would soften hearts. Relationships would be reconciled and restored. You would do a work that only you can do, God. And we come to you at the communion table, taking together in unity of your body and your blood. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God